everyone, welcome back to my channel. I'm Shikha, and in this video I'm going to discuss another important topic, that is an essay by Philip Sidney. The name of the essay is An Apology for Poetry, which is also called as A Defense of Poesy. But please don't get confused here, because there is one more essay with a similar name, that is A Defense of Poesy by P.B. Shelley. So this essay had been written in around 1585, the same year when Philip Sidney died. And the essay had been published in 1595, after 10 years. Okay, when Philip Sidney had already died in 1585, the essay had been published after the death of Philip Sidney in 1595. Important thing that you must know about this essay is, in 1595, when this essay got published, it opened the age of literary criticism. What it means is that when this essay got published, all other critics, they started writing in the field of, or in the area of literary criticism. They started writing the piece of literary criticism after this essay. And another thing that you must know is that this essay was the reply to another essay, that was the School of Abuse, and that essay was written by Stephen Gosson. So Stephen Gosson was the person, he was basically a critique, and he was the person who was writing in the same period, Elizabethan period. He was the Puritan basically, and he was against the idea of the poetry, and he was a follower of Plato. Okay, so whatever the Plato was saying, he was following that, and he was against the idea of the poetry. He basically questioned the morality of the poetry in his essay, The School of Abuse. And his essay, The School of Abuse, was the reply to Sidney's idea of poetry. Earlier as well, Sidney was a poet, that you know, and he was writing the poetries. He was kind of defending the poetries. But Stephen Gosson, he was questioning the morality of poetry and other forms of literature. According to him, that poetry and other forms of literature, they don't teach you anything. That's the same thing what Plato said in his period, and he was saying the same thing, that they don't teach you anything, they don't teach you any morality. So he was against the idea of poetry, and he was also against the Sidney, who was defending the poetry at his initial stage. But later, when Sidney, Philip Sidney, he read his essay, The School of Abuse, in his reply, he has written this essay, An Apology for Poetry, which was published in 1595. So this essay was a reply to the School of Abuse. In that essay, Stephen Gosson, he had made a few charges against the poetry. I'll tell you about those charges later in my video, so please stick to this video. First, let's see what Sidney says in his essay, An Apology for Poetry. So Philip Sidney begins his essay talking about the earliest time, and he said that poetry has been held in high esteem since the earliest period, and poetry has also been considered as the first light giver to the ignorance, because all the historians and philosophers, even they were poets, and whatever they used to teach to the other people, whatever they used to write in poetry form. So even they were poets, all the, you know, scholars, all the, you know, educated people, they were in fact poets. And even among the uncivilized nation, all the uncivilized nation, even among them, poetry enjoyed a, you know, an undiminishing popularity. Even among the uncivilized nation, poetry enjoyed an undiminishing popularity. So to attack the poetry, it would be, you know, attacking the culture and intelligence. It would be attacking the roots of our culture. Okay, so this is what Sidney says. Further, Sidney says that all the Romans and Greeks, they paid high reverence to the poets, and they called them waits. Waits means a prophet, a diviner, and a foreseer. So, and if we go to the, you know, origin of the word, the poet, it means to make. the word, the poet, it means to make. So all those Greeks and Romans, they honored poets and called them the creator and the maker. So it kind of suggests the divine nature of the poetry. Further, in his essay, Sidney divides his poetry into three sections. The first one is religious poetry. In religious poetry, he says that religious poetries are the ones that teaches you some moral lesson. The second one we have is philosophical poetry, that teaches you some kind of philosophy of their life. The third one we have is poetry as an imaginative treatment of life in nature. So he gives the special kind of treatment to the third kind of poetry, that is poetry as an imaginative treatment of life in nature. So here Sidney says that the aim of the poetry is to teach and delight, to do both the things simultaneously. But the first two things, religious poetries and the philosophical poetries, they do one thing at certain time. Okay, either they will teach you, or they will give you some moral lesson, or they will teach you some philosophies of life. But in the third kind of poetry, he talks about the aim of the poetry, that is to teach and delight, something that should amuse to the audience, or something that should teach some moral lesson to the audience. Sidney further talks about the superiority of poetry to philosophy and history. Poetry, according to Sidney, is superior to philosophy by its charm, to history by its universality, and to science by its moral end. Sidney here says that poetry is superior than all other branches of science, including history and philosophy, because philosophy, it gives you some theoretical aspects and it teaches you virtues by giving some theoretical aspects. And with respect to history, Sidney says that it teaches you practical virtues by drawing concrete examples from life. So poetry is kind of superior because it has the power to move the mind of the reader for the virtuous actions, and it presents all the moral lessons in the attractive manner or in the delightful manner. So this is the thing that why poetry is superior than philosophy and history. Sidney then talks about a common complaint against the poetry. He says that all the critiques, they claim that poetry is all about rhyming and versing the content, and whenever we attempt to write something, we are just bound up within the boundaries of rhyming and versing our content. But Sidney here says that poetry is not all about rhyming and versing. They are there to just beautify your content. It just polish your speech, because it gives verbal harmony and it gives pleasure to the content, because it also helps you memorizing the things. If you consider all the children, even they find all the lullabies very interesting and pleasurable to their ears, and they are able to memorizing all the things in versifying manners and all the things in rhyming form. So it is easier to become, it is easier to memorizing things in verse form. They are not the essential part to the poetry, but they are just there to gives or add the pleasure to the content, or add the verbal harmony to the content. That's it. They are not the essential part of the poetry. At last, now come back to all the charges that Stephen Gosson had made in his pamphlet, The School of Abuse. Earlier in my video, I talked about Stephen Gosson and his idea of poetry, that he was against the poetry and he questioned the morality of the poetry. And in his pamphlet, The School of Abuse, he made certain charges against the poetry. The first one, he says that poetry is just a waste of time. The second one, he says that poetry is mother of lies. Third one, he says that poetry is nurse to abuse. The fourth one, he says that Plato was right in his time about banishing poet from the ideal world. So Sydney at last replies to all the charges that had been made by Stephen Gisson in his pamphlet. So for the first charge, that was poetry is a waste of time, Sydney responds and he says that how can poetry be a waste of time when it is superior than all other branches of science? It is superior to history, it is superior to philosophy. Like I told you why it was superior to philosophy and history. And further Sydney says that it has a power to, you know, move the, you know, reader's mind to the virtuous actions, into the virtuous actions, and it is superior than all other branches. So how can you say that it is just a waste of time? Because it is more fruitful than all other branches of science. So poetry cannot be, you know, a waste of time, but rather it is more fruitful because it teaches you and delights you at the same time. So it cannot be the waste of time. So for the second charge, that was poetry is the mother of lies, Sydney says that how can poetry be the mother of lies? Because poets, they never affirm anything. All the historians, all the philosophers, if you see them, they present certain facts that how it should be done and how it should not be done. But if you consider all the poets, they do not affirm anything. They just present something in front of your eyes and they give you the opportunity to consider what is right and what is wrong for you. They are just, you know, kind of romanticizing all the things. They did not, you know, assert anything that this thing is right and this thing is wrong. So how can they lie about something? Because they do not affirm anything at all. Okay, so that was the second charge. So for the third charge, that was poetry is nurse to abuse. Here Stephen was saying that poetry corrupts people. It makes people effeminate because they include love themes and all other themes. These things corrupt our society. So to that Sydney says that yes, I do agree that there are love themes, and about you know, contemporary poet, they do include love themes and all other things in their modern poetry, but it is not the fault of the poetry, it is the fault of the poets, because they do not talk about any morality, they do not teach anything, they are just talking about these things in their poetry. On the other hand, Sydney also says that love in itself is not that bad because it is a kind of appreciation to the beauty, but using the love theme in the right manner is a, you know, a important thing that one must know while writing the poetry. So it is not the fault of the poetry, but fault lies in the poets. So Sydney was saying that poetry does not abuse men's wit, but it is men's wit that abuses poetry. Okay, so this was the third charge. Regarding the fourth and last charge, where Stephen was saying that Plato was right enough about banishing poets from the ideal world. To that Sydney was saying, he was saying that Plato was not talking about the poets only, because he himself was kind of poets. If you see most of his writings, they were in the verse form. If you consider his work Ion, even that work was in verse form. So he was not against the poets or the poetries. He was just against the abuse of the poetry, and he was just talking about the banishing of the abuse of the poetry, or the banishing of all the immoral poets who abuses poetry. So he was not against the poetry. So these were all the charges that Stephen had made, and Sydney in his essay was replying to all other charges, and he was, you know, this essay, An Apology of Poetry, it was not just a reply to Stephen Gosson's pamphlet, The School of Abuse, but it is a kind of reply to all other works who were against the poetry. So in this essay, Philip Sidney was basically defending the poetry, and he was against all those critics who were criticizing poetry. So that's it for the essay. I hope you have understood it and you have understood all the ideas of Philip Sidney about poetry. So we'll meet in the next one. I'll come up with another important topic from UGC Net point of view. Till then, bye bye, take care and happy reading. Thank you.